You know, Jesus did a complete work. Let me say again. You know, Jesus did a complete work. Jesus did not leave your account unsettled so that you can go and settle with your uncles. Jesus never left your account unsettled so that you can go and settle with your dead grandfathers and fathers and mothers and everybody. He never left your account unsettled. He settled your account 100%. Jesus never left your account unsettled so that you can go and settle with another person somewhere, another thing somewhere. Jesus settled your account completely. Bwana Yesu asifiwe sana. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Sometimes when mothers give birth and their children are crying so much in the night, I hear some people in the tradition telling them, there's something you have not settled with the mother-in-law. There's something you have not settled with your mother. There's something the grandmother is asking for. There's something to do with your grandmother. You know, all those things are not what God has called you for. When you have been settled by Christ, He settled you 100%. You are told, if it is a son of God, if the son set you free, you will not be free 75%. And then you are trying to load 75% with your uncles. No, you are free and free indeed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So if your child cries, tell your child, have peace, son. Have peace, my daughter. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are no things that are not settled. It is settled forever. I say nothing is unsettled. It is settled forever. You just need to walk with that kind of knowledge and you'll be free and free indeed. Hallelujah. You know, in God or in a human life, and more so when we talk about spiritual matters, the question is not whether something miraculous has happened. The question is the source. Yeah, because some people are confused because they even go to a man with evil spirit and they will tell them the truth. You remember the evil spirit in the book of Acts who are telling the servant of God, these are the servant of God. They were saying the truth. So the validity of the voice is not how accurate the voice is. The validity of a voice is the source of the voice. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even devils can see some things in the realm of the spirit. And you hear somebody say, hey, that person, he told me the truth. Saying the truth does not mean it is true. Hallelujah. Amen. Or saying the truth does not mean it has validated the source. Bwana Yesu asifiwe sana. Hallelujah. So when you take your children to grandmothers and others because they are crying and all that, you see what you have just done? You have created a dependency that tomorrow if the grandmother decides that this child will cry until you bring a goat, then you are at the mercies of that grandmother. You need to be at the mercies of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Who will never misuse you, who will never mishandle you, who will never harass you. Mtu aseme hallelujah. I'm so glad that I've been saved and been set free by Jesus Christ, not by the will of men. Hallelujah. We have been set free not by the will of men, but by the will of God. But by the will of God. In the name of Jesus Christ. Are you getting blessed as we continue? It's good to see you. It's good to see God having taken care of you the whole week. And I know that is a big, big testimony. Yeah, it's a big testimony to see you. To see you having been taken care of. It is the grace of God. It is the grace of God. Hallelujah. I will touch something briefly this morning before we go back to what we are sharing on Sunday. And I will pick from where we started on Wednesday, because when God speaks, he does not speak to just excite for a day. God gives a message. God gives a message so that now the people can be able to ride at another higher level in terms of faith. God speaks to us so that now we can operate. Our spirits can be lifted to another level where we are operating at the frequency of God, at the level of God. When the Bible says that with God, all things are possible, and all things are possible to them that believe. It means when you have faith and confidence in God, faith brings you to a place of operating at the will of God. You operate at the frequency of God. Your spirit is lifted to begin operating at the frequency of God, at the frequency of the will of God. Hallelujah. That's why we pray. That's why we praise. That's why we worship. That's why we have time, you know, just to celebrate God. So that now our spirit man can be ignited. Our spirit man can be lifted to a place where now we can operate at the level or at the will of the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. That's why we pray. That's why we pray. That's why we came here this morning and we took time just to worship God, to pray, to just to praise him. What we are doing is that we are aligning our spirits, you know, because you cannot empower the Spirit of God more than he is empowered. Yeah, we are just aligning our spirits so that now we can tune to the frequency of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, that is why we pray. That's why a man who does not take his time to pray, to praise God, to do what? Yes, you are born again. But you may really operate at a dimension, at a level of, you know, walking in the will of God or operating in the direction of the Spirit. You miss so much of the leading of the Spirit of God because your spirit man is like a candle that is not lit. Yeah, ni msuma ambao haujawekwa moto. Therefore, kuna giza bado, because the Bible talks about that the spirit of man is a candle of God. What about when that candle is off? It doesn't help you. Hallelujah. So take your time, pray, take your time, and worship, take your time and have the word of God, take your time and position your spirit to receive godly directions, to receive godly direction in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah, you just connect yourself, you just position yourself to be able to operate at the frequency of God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Did you know that the voice of God is a small, still voice? Therefore, you have to silence many things within your system to hear that voice. I say you have to silence so many things within your system. You have to silence your carnality. You have to silence, you know, what you have heard from people and all that. So that now you tune to the frequency. You tune to the frequency. Hallelujah. I have taught you the consistency of the character of God, that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So God is not changing by your prayer. Even if you pray for 100 days, prayer and fasting, God does not change. What that fasting has done, that fasting has helped you to be in tune with the will of God. So that you don't beat the air. So that you don't just run without direction. So that you don't just do things from your head. You are able to follow the leading of the Spirit. Hallelujah. And that's why we agreed that we don't pray because we have a problem. We don't fast because we have a problem. Yeah, it is a way of keeping your spirit man, tuned to the frequency of God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Yeah, yeah. When your spirit man is well tuned to the will of God, some of the things that you are looking for so hard, you discover they were just next to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a woman in the Bible, was it called Hagar? And she was in a desperate situation where her child needed water. Yeah, and the child was almost dying of thirst. But the instructions of God were just turn, and you will see a well just next to you. Look at Abraham when he went to sacrifice the son. When he was about to sacrifice the son, the voice of God came and told Abraham, you don't have to do that. Just turn and you will see. There is a lamb just next to you. Amen. Prayer, fasting, praising, worshiping, all that does not make God do something he has not done. Actually, God has finished his work. It just opens your eyes. It just opens your ears to hear that voice of God that is telling you, this is the way. This is the way. This is the way. Hallelujah. Now you can see who is disadvantaged when there is no prayer, when there is no fasting, when there is no that life of dedication unto God. It's not God that loses. Yeah, it's not even the church that loses. It is that man who is not positioning himself. And you know, let me keep on saying this because I know I must be speaking to somebody. I must be speaking to somebody. Amen. Say, I am the one. Say, I am the one. So when you do not do that, you can go round in circles. You can go round in circles. And yet your help was just next door. Yet your help was just next, you know, point. Yeah. You can just go round and round and round. And you're wondering, why is my help not forthcoming? Your help is just next door. Hallelujah. Yeah. One of the servants of the prophet told, I was challenging the prophet and saying, see how great an army is coming against us and they want to kill us. And the prophet said, Lord, open his eyes. Open his eyes that he may see how many people we have on our side. And when the eyes were open, he saw a great army. And the army was there. The army was there. The problem was his eyes were closed. The eyes were closed. Hallelujah. So our participation, our involvement, our responsibility as believers, it is to make sure that we remain in tune with the will of God so that we don't miss his plan. We don't miss his purpose. We don't miss his agenda. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Are you saying an amen to that? Amen. Hallelujah. Otherwise, God has finished blessing you. It is your work now to discover the blessings. Did you know that? God has already finished blessing you. He has already blessed you with spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. He has already blessed you. He has already done. He has already blessed you. God is through with healing anybody healable. God is through with releasing resources that we all need. It is now our responsibility to have our eyes open. That's why Paul was praying such a big prayer, that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know, hallelujah, you know, the will of God and the hope of his calling. Hallelujah. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Hallelujah. So that's why we came. That's why I will keep on telling you, any believer who is casual with the things of God, they will never see a meaningful walk with God. They will never have a meaningful walk with God. They will never realize how great a privilege they have in terms of being saved and having the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. If you don't know what you have, you will underuse it. You'll underuse it. On Tuesday, the Spirit of God gave us a word that was not just to make us feel good on Tuesday. But there are things that the Spirit of God speaks to you and you know. It is an enlightenment for greater levels. It is an enlightenment to take you to another level. Now, on Tuesday, we looked at the grace of God. We looked at the masses of God. We also looked at something about the peace of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we were able to look at something, and we discovered that most of the letters that Paul sent to the churches, there is a statement that Paul would give all the time. Let's look at that scripture or a kind of the search. Ephesians chapter number 1 and verse number 2. And you discover that most of that statement was appearing in chapter 1 of the letter and verse number 2. Most of that statement was appearing there. When you go to the book of Philippians, Colossians, First Corinthians, and all that, you discover that that statement was appearing in the first chapter and mostly in the second verse. Hallelujah. We see Paul is saying, let's start from verse number 1. We see Paul saying, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Verse number 2. We see grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. We see grace be to you and peace. Paul was very emphatic when he was ministering to different churches. The church in Ephesians, the church in Philippines, the church in Corinthians. One of his hashtags, if we may use the language for today, was that Paul was telling the church that grace be to you and peace. Grace be to you and peace. And I told you on Sunday by the help of God that it is not possible to walk in peace. It's not possible to know peace. It's not possible to walk in peace until you know the grace of God. Can I hear an amen? Amen. You cannot be able to walk in the peace of God until you know the grace of God. Until you know the grace of God. Nikakwambia kwamba, mtu utembea katika amani. Ile unaweza kuita blessed assurance in your spirit when you discover and understand the grace of God. Before you understand the grace of God, no matter how much you try to really be right with God, and there's nothing wrong with being right with God. There's nothing wrong with trying or doing everything right. There's nothing wrong. We are called to walk in the light of God. Somebody say an amen. But until the day you would know the grace of God, then you discover that in many times your effort may frustrate you. Your effort may frustrate you. Yeah, may frustrate you. Your effort may frustrate you. What do I mean that your effort may frustrate you? That you, when you try to quote unquote look right, be right, walk right, and you feel like there's still something that you're not able to really, get there. And before you know the grace of God, that may frustrate you. That may deny you a lot of peace with God because you feel, I am not good enough. I am not righteous enough. I am not accepted enough. I am not this and that enough. We get to a place of peace when we understand the grace of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. We get to a place of peace when we understand the grace of God. Amen. Let's see something from the book of Philippians. Philippians 4, chapter number 1. Therefore, my beloved, or my brethren, dearly beloved, and longed for. That version, I am not sure which one it is. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, it's okay, and long for, my joy and crown. So stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Verse number 2 or the next verse. I beseech your dear and beseech saintage. Where? And they be of the same mind in the Lord. Verse number 3. And entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel. Even though we are not talking about that, allow me to pause there and tell you this. That injili ni kazi. Kuhubiri injili, kueneza injili, kuestablish churches and all that, iyo ni kazi kubwa sana. That's why Paul is saying that the women who labored with me in the gospel, because it is a lot of labor, ni kazi kubwa sana. Wale watu wajachukua hii kiwa ni kazi mzito ama ni kazi serious, ndio wanafanya mambo mchezo mchezo. Yeah, you need to know when God has given us an opportunity to preach the gospel, he has actually put on our shoulder a lot of work. A lot of work. And that's why everybody must take it very seriously. This is not just another story. It's not just another small thing to do. When we have been given a work to do by God, we need to know that it is labor. It is labor. So when you are not doing, when you are doing nothing, when you are not laboring, when it has cost you nothing, please know, probably you may not be called a laborer. A laborer. Yeah. Wewe sio mfanyikazi. Unfortunately, in many churches, only a very small percentage labor. Very small percentage. One of the writers of leadership is called Reverend J.C. Maxwell. He says that only 20%, study shows like only 20% in a church that are very committed. Yeah. In fact, I read another book by Bishop Doug Herod Mills, and he was saying, for you to grow a mega church as a pastor, please, you must know this, that people are not as committed as you think. Yeah. That one must sink in a pastor's head so that the pastor cannot die prematurely. Hallelujah. So that the pastor cannot die prematurely. So the gospel is labor. The gospel is labor. The work of ministry is labor. Tell your neighbor, it is work. It is a lot of labor. Yeah. Nikibarua kikubwa. And there are people, there are so many people. Actually, the vast majority of believers, they are very idle. They do nothing in their churches. They are just there. They come and they see and they go. They come, watch what is happening, they go. Yeah. They will come and go. I've challenged many of you that you cannot be in a church. Let's start with this one. You cannot be in a church for 1 month, for 2 months, for 6 months, and you're still finishing services and picking your bag and running home. That is very questionable. That's very questionable. You need to get to a place where you are involved, where you labor. Praise the name of the Lord. You know, some people, Pastor Purity, they will tell you, I'm very busy on Saturday. Okay, let's see how they can be involved on Sunday. Am I talking to people here now? Yeah, you don't come to Sanctuary Keep on Saturday because assumingly you are very busy on Saturday. Okay, what happens after Sunday service? Why don't you have some 15 minutes even to wipe one of tiles? Are you still very busy? No, it's not that you are busy. You have never taken the work of God as serious work. To you, it's nothing to labor for. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So let's see that kind of commitment. Uliza mwenzako unakuwa busy kila saa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you. I'm informed I'm live on Facebook. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you. So it is important to know that. It's good to know that. Praise the name of the Lord. It's good to know that. Yeah. You must be involved. You cannot be an attendee from the time you got saved to 10 years ago. You're just an attendee of church. It doesn't work like that. Ministry is a lot of labor. Ministry is a lot of labor. Yeah. A lot of labor. My father and my bishop told me this, that in ministry, some people will only get like 5% of what is happening. Then he told me, for such, only commit them to the extent they understand. There are people you don't even bother with them so much because they get very small things. Therefore, they just understand. For example, when you're telling them, come and pick the chair, put there. If you don't tell them, after you have only. So you just deal with them like that. There are some people who understand ministry, 30%. And he told me, I handle them as so. To the extent that you understand is the way I'm going to relate with you. Hallelujah. If you understand 100%, then you look like you are the favorite of the pastor. You look like pastor-like, you know, are giving you a lot of responsibility and all that. It's not like pastor-like you does not like the other person. It is the level of understanding that is causing the pastor to behave as so. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. And you know, I personally tell myself this. Anytime you see a person that cannot do anything until they are told, it really challenges me. Because it tells me that person has very little understanding. Because any person can do something when instructed. It takes a mature man to be self-driven. Any man can be very good when monitored and supervised and all that. It takes maturity to still do the same when you're not monitored.
All over this room. Hallelujah.
Personal say, you have one.